night see the sun. This weekend is an exception. Thankfully, we are warmed by that sunshine, and knowing that we will enter the Lenten season next week, our 40-day journey, as we prepare ourselves to follow Jesus into Jerusalem and to his crucifixion and his resurrection. This morning, we remember and celebrate an event on a mountain in Israel. Perhaps Mount Tabor or Mount Hermon, not too huge by our standards, but climbable. And on this mountain, Jesus took his disciples, Peter, James, and John, and there they saw an incredible sight. Moses and Elijah and Jesus, all three, changed into beings of light, and a cloud enveloping them. The voice of God saying again, as was said at his baptism, "This is my Son, the Beloved, on whom I am well pleased." And this time saying also, "Listen to him." Extraordinary and frightening, awe-inspiring, to see Jesus and the others talking together, glowing white and radiant. And then, only Jesus remaining, and the voice of God. So too, we read this morning in our Hebrew scriptures that Moses is called by God to ascend Mount Sinai, and there he receives the law on tablets of stone. His face is shining because he has spoken directly with God, transfigured. I will look forward to seeing that interpreted in the movie The Ten Commandments during the Jewish Passover and on our Easter Vigil night, one of our cultural icons. Moses, remember Moses' face full of light, his hair turned white, clutching the tablets of stone containing the commandments of God for the people. So Jesus is the further manifestation of God to God's people. Peter, James, and John have a true mountaintop experience, and they will try to process all of this as they come back down the mountain and wonder in awe and confusion and some fear what this will mean, as Jesus tells them that he must die and be raised from the dead. Confusion, fear, anxiety, awe, uncertainty, wonder. What does this mean to follow a man who can heal and perform miracles and teach so profoundly and then die and be raised? And they love him. What will happen next? This all resonates with us as we live our own journeys of faith. We all need transfiguration moments in our lives in order to keep going and to have hope. Where have you experienced such moments? They may be less dramatic, but they remind us that God is always here and now. I am remembering one such moment this past summer when one of our choral scholars, with our organ scholar accompanying her, sang the Lord's Prayer. And when she finished that last Amen and he played that last chord, this church was transfigured. The energy was so strong. I hope you were here. It was amazing. For one moment, suspended in a moment of God's glory. Oh. Before you leave today, climb the steps to the second landing and view the painting of the Transfiguration. It hung for many years behind the altar in the St. Mary's Chapel. It was severely damaged and semi-successfully repaired, but it is still beautiful, beautiful and remarkable. Let that be a visual focus for your prayer and meditation this week. As we enter the season of Lent, I encourage you to also contemplate again what it means for you to be a follower of Jesus and to share his journey to the cross and beyond. First, with the pancakes on Trove Tuesday, and then the compelling invitation on Ash Wednesday to prepare for his passion, death, and resurrection by a season of devotion, prayer, and fasting. There will be many ways for you to do this here at St. Mark's, and some other ways in our own community. Watch for them. I ask you to recommit to daily prayer and reflection, using perhaps one of the booklets available in our resource tables. At a time when there is so much discord and chaos in our world, here is a time and a place when we can commit to that which is focused on our inward journey of self-examination and commitment to living a life which is more in line with the teacher whose example we